This video will cover our work on the perception of facial expressions and the neural mechanisms involved in this process. The work appears in the Journal of Neuroscience. A link to it can be found on our website. This research was done at The Ohio State University by my colleagues Ramprakash Srinivasan, Jovi Gollum, and myself. Look at this video. What do you see? Is this person approachable? Is he interacting with someone? Avoiding them? Maybe laughing at a disgusting joke? In order to answer these questions, our brain performs a series of computations that provide us with the necessary information to not only interpret this person's actions and intent, but to determine how we should respond. But what are these computations? To understand these seemingly effortlessly computations, we first need to explain how facial expressions are produced. As shown in this illustration, muscles under our skin contract and relax to produce facial expressions. To make life easier on us, it is convenient to provide a unique number to each of these possible muscle actions. These are called action units. For example, as seen here, action unit 1, or AU1, defines a contraction of the muscles that moves the inner corners of the eyebrows up, while AU2 defines a contraction of the muscle that moves the outer corners of the brows up. Let us now see the result that AU12 has on an image. AU12 is a contraction of a cheek muscle which results in the pulling of the lips. This yields clearly visible image changes, as you can see in this image. We define facial actions as these visible changes and use action units as a way to annotate them. Here are the four action units we included in our study, AUs 1, 2, 12, and 20. Note that each AU is common in many facial expressions. In fact, action units are the building blocks of facial expressions, allowing us to construct many facial expressions of emotion, produce language, and other nonverbal communication signals. Our hypothesis is that to visually interpret facial expressions, our brain must solve the inverse problem. That is, our brain must identify which action units are active in a face. Specifically, we hypothesize that the brain region where this visual recognition takes place is the posterior superior temporal sulcus, or pSTS, which is thought to increase its neural activity when we observe biological movements. To test our hypothesis, we perform an fMRI study. fMRI stands for functional magnetic resonance imaging. Here, a participant lays comfortably in an MRI, which is a big magnet that can take three-dimensional pictures of the brain. To do this, the brain is divided into three-dimensional voxels of about 3 by 3 by 3 by 3 millimeters. The word functional means that we estimate the amount of neural activation in each of these voxels by measuring the quantity of oxygenation in blood. More oxygen correlates with higher neural activity. The neural activity on each of these voxels is measured while the participant observes a set of facial expressions. Our experiment is designed in such a way that half of the images the participant sees have AU1 present, while the other half do not. The same is true for the other AUs. Half of the images have that AU present, half don't. The fMRI acquisitions we collected are represented here by stars, with red indicating AU was present and yellow not present. Note, they are plotted in a feature space where the dimensions correspond to each of the voxels. That is, each of these dimensions specifies how much neural activity there is in each voxel. Of course, we are only showing the values of two voxels, even though there are thousands of them in the brain. We have also included the feature spaces of the brains of two participants. This illustrates how the activation of each participant is slightly different. Clearly, our brains are not exactly alike. To align these subject-specific representations, we use a linear transformation known as principal components analysis, or PCA. After these representations have been aligned, we can use machine learning classifiers to learn to discriminate between the acquisitions that correspond to images with a certain AU present versus images with that AU not present. This step is called the learning phase because it is here that we learn to identify when the brain is decoding an image with a specific AU active. When we have data of an independent participant who was not used during this training phase, we talk about testing. During testing, we do not know which acquisitions correspond to images with a specific AU present and which don't. This is indicated by the blue colored stars. After projecting the blue stars from the subject-specific space to the aligned representation, we see which ones are on the red side, indicating that the AU is present, and which on the yellow side, indicating that the AU is not present. Hence, we can now ask you to get in the MRI, and while we show you images, our computer can look into the neural activity of your brain and robustly and fully automatically identify which action units you're looking at. In fact, the computer only needs to look at one at the red and yellow voxels shown here. These voxels are, of course, in the pSTS, and thus, these results support our hypothesis of a neural mechanism for the recognition of action units in this brain region. We also know that this region is less active or even silent in autism, suggesting a mechanism by which facial expression analysis is impaired in these and other disorders. You can learn more about these and related projects on our website, where you will find a multitude of teaching and research resources.